Is BBC One. Now, Desmond Lynam looks back with this week's guest Sylvia Peters in It's My Pleasure.
You know that nice introduction to the programme before our opening titles came from a disembodied voice, didn't it? Wasn't always the case in BBC television. Once upon a time, in those black and white days, you would have seen the announcer. In fact, in those times, you saw a great deal of the announcers, who were certainly as famous as anyone appearing in the actual programmes. My guest was probably the best known of all.
Tonight, I'm not speaking to you from the familiar studios at Alexandra Palace, but from a small room in the new transmitting station at Sutton Coldfield. On behalf of the BBC, I offer a special greeting and a warm welcome to our new viewers in the Midlands. Here to open the transmitting station officially are the Postmaster General, the Right Honourable Wilfrid Paling, the Vice Chairman of the BBC, the Dowager Marchioness of Reading, Sir William Haley, Director General of the BBC, and the Mayor of Sutton Coldfield, Councillor H. Hothersall.
It's my pleasure to welcome Sylvia Peters. I must say, that all seemed terribly formal.
It was awful, wasn't it?
Well, I wouldn't say it was awful, but it was formal.
I think I was awful. Terribly formal, and do you realise I'd learned every word of it because we didn't have an order cue in those days.
Quiet. How did you remember all the names in the right order?
I just don't know.
And keep a smile on your face
and
at the
I
same
had to
time.
Keep on smiling. And it was a very small room we were in.
Yes.
And I do remember Lady Reading was wearing a sort of thing that looked like a death dog around her shoulders of fur, which she kept on for the opening ceremony. And that was keeping a smile on my face, actually.
Mm. You got into the business, I think, because your mother encouraged you, wasn't that right?
Yes, till I was on the stage. I was a dancer.
Yes.
And she didn't think it was very nice. And she thought...
She thought this was nice, did you?
Well, you see, in those days, the BBC was considered to be terribly, terribly respectable.
Yes. Times have changed,
mm. You're telling me. And so she made me apply, and as I didn't want the job, I suppose that's why I got it. I was totally relaxed about the whole thing. Oh, I don't care.
Yes.
You know, the show I was in had come off, and I was sort of between shows, and I did the test, and that was it.
What did you do on the stage? Were you?
I was a dancer.
You were a dancer?
I was in musical comedy.
Right. Mm. So the spoken word was sort of...
Well, know. Almost foreign to me in a way.
Mm.
I went to the arts educational school, so I did do a little bit of drama, and I loved the ballet, but I wasn't good enough to be, you know, in a real ballet company, which I'd have loved. So I went into musical comedy. I sang as well. No, the spoken word was not really me.
Yes. It certainly became you.
Well, I suppose it did, but the way I was speaking there, it was terribly cut class, wasn't it?
You've got some interesting clips for us to see that you've chosen.
Well, I hope so,
and
yes.
The first is from Panorama.
Well, it's that lovely April the 1st joke that Richard Dimbleby played on everybody. The spaghetti harvest.
The last 2 weeks of March are an anxious time for the spaghetti farmer. There's always the chance of a late frost, which, while not entirely ruining the crop, generally impairs the flavour and makes it difficult for him to obtain top prices in world markets. But now these dangers are over and the spaghetti harvest goes forward. Spaghetti cultivation here in Switzerland is not, of course, carried out on anything like the tremendous scale of the Italian industry. Many of you, I'm sure, will have seen pictures of the vast spaghetti plantations in the Po Valley. For the Swiss, however, it tends to be more of a family affair. Another reason why this may be a bumper year lies in the virtual disappearance of the spaghetti weevil, the tiny creature whose depredations have caused much concern in the past. After picking, the spaghetti is laid out to dry in the warm alpine sun. Many people are often puzzled by the fact that spaghetti is produced at such uniform length. But this is the result of many years of patient endeavor by plant breeders who've succeeded in producing the perfect spaghetti.
Well, of course, anything that Richard Dimbleby did in those days was legitimate.
You know, everybody believed it.
Yes.
And, you know, the idea came from the cameraman called Charles de Jager, because he was at school in Austria, and apparently his teacher used to say, "You're so stupid, you probably think spaghetti grows on trees." And this is how he got the idea.
Right.
And because it was Richard, who was, you know, mostly serious, everybody believed it.
Did you work much with Richard Dimbleby?
Well, I did. Mm. Not a lot, but we had a hilarious week in Paris, the two of us. I mean, this was work. It was one of the first...
Oh, yes.
It was one of the first Eurovision links. We did a week in Paris, a very traumatic week, I can tell you. It's the first time I've ever seen Richard Dimbleby lose his temper. But we, the French were very primitive in those days, and they had no link with the control van. They had a sort of chain of men who would sort of pass signals down to you. So the one nearest was dressed in an appropriate habit. So in Notre Dame, a monk was seen to glide up to Richard. And then he sort of glided away. Well, that was the floor manager giving him the cue. And then he...
We've got one dressed like that here, actually.
Have you? Oh, well, I mean, this, it was awful. And they kept having 2 hours for lunch. And we knew the shows were terrible. And in the end, Richard said, "Well, let us have 2 hours for lunch." And so we did, but it was a bit traumatic. I mean, he threw a chair in the Seine once, in the middle of a programme.
Did he?
And I don't know whether that was ever seen in England. Yes, the French commentator was upstaging him with this chair, and he suddenly got it and said, "I don't think we need this, do you?" And he just chucked it in the river.
But, you always seemed so composed and so relaxed, and you always had a lovely smile. But what was going on inside? Were you as nervous as most television performers actually are?
I don't think I was terribly nervous. No. For some reason, I took to the medium, and I used to laugh a lot because everybody used to make me giggle. I was a terrible giggler. I used to get into trouble for that.
Yes.
So I think I was quite relaxed, yes. I mean, people used to do awful things to make me laugh.
Well, I mean, of course, you worked with Peter Hagen, Mac Hobley, and
yes,
people like that, and I guess they were the
villains
of the piece.
They were pretty naughty, but the villains were really the floor managers, because they were there to cue me. And one used to throw nuts at me, and if one went down my cleavage, just as I was going to say good evening, that was a real, you know, bonus, and I would fall about with laughter. I used to get told off for it.
Did you?
I used to laugh through the weather. We used to do the weather report.
Oh, yes, they didn't have weathermen then, did they?
You know, I could see funny meanings in the weather report, can you believe? Well, we did have one announcer once. She was a deputy, and she actually read that a trough of low pleasure was approaching from Northern Ireland.
Let's have a look at the second clip that you've picked, and An Englishman Abroad.
Something more serious. I thought this was the most wonderful play.
It's the story of Guy Burgess, isn't it,
yes,
in Moscow?
And
a true
Coral
story.
And Coral Brown playing herself, isn't she?
Alan
I love
Bates
the way she cleans the glass.
Yes.
Before she drinks out of it.
That was Alan Bates playing Guy Burgess, of course.
Wonderful,
yes,
actor, yes.
Yes. Yes. Tell me something. I'm told that you had a photographic memory for you mentioned learning the script just now. Could you just look at a sheet of paper and just remember it
like
that?
I could. Now I go in a room and I wonder what I've gone in for, you know, it's not like that. Yes, I did have. I don't know why, but I did have a photographic memory.
Well,
I think it's the only reason I got the job. Because you couldn't have an auto cue in those days. So you had to learn reams of awful stuff, really.
It's a remarkable facility, and of course you didn't necessarily write that stuff yourself. It was
not at the beginning. No, I used to go and beg the people that wrote it to change it, because some of it was so awful. But we did win through in the end. We were able to put it in our own words, provided we gave a 10-second cue out. So that wasn't so bad, but some of it was awful.
Yes. And what did they actually get you to do when you had an audition, when you came to work for the BBC in the first place? What did you have to go through?
Lots of funny things. The first funny thing was to walk down a flight of stairs. And as you know, no announcer's never seen below the waist. So why did they do that? Well, you had to chat to somebody and you did announcements. And then they suddenly said to me, tell a fairy story right now in your own words without any sort of warning and look at the camera to do it. So I told the story of the three bears, which apparently went down quite well.
Yes.
And then I had to interview MacDonald Hobley. And that was lovely, actually.
He made it easy for you, did he?
Oh, no, he made it difficult. Deliberately, I think he'd been told to, because I said, should I sit down or should I stand up? I didn't know what television was. And they said, it's up to you, you know. And I thought, well, what shall I do with this man? I did ask him to sit down and asked him, you know, what he'd done in television. And then I had to do foreign names. I had to read out bits of Italian opera titles, you know, to see whether I could pronounce things properly. It was quite a hard
daunting
audition.
I would imagine.
It was really, and really it went on for months because they were testing girls all the time, that they had me on trial, as it were. And they thought I was a bit young, because I, you know, I'm not putting a line, but I was very young.
Yes, so you must be.
But the time I got the job, I had grown a bit older. Yes, I was 20 when I first went there.
Well, you were 20 when you first appeared regularly on television. Heavens. One of the great stars of that time was, of course, Gilbert Harding, and you've selected a clip of Gilbert on Face to Face for us to see.
Many memories of Gilbert, yes.
Let's have a look at it first.
Right.
Do you, in ordinary life, dream a lot?
I dream constantly, yes.
I wonder what sort of dreams. Dreams of violence, for instance?
No, I...
Anxiety?
Anxieties, yes, an impossible situation.
Are you apt to be the dominant figure?
No, on the whole, I'm the sort of suffering person.
Do you dream about your work?
No, I dream about unpleasant situations in which I might have been in and got out of, and my dreams are that I didn't get out of them and they developed horribly. Sometimes I remember them, sometimes I don't.
Are you conscious that this is at all an oppressive factor in your life?
No, I'm aware of no particular oppressive factor.
That was with John Freeman, the famous face-to-face program.
Yes, those marvellous face-to-face interviews.
Yes. And I think
wonderful.
Gilbert Harding was, he was terribly upset by that broadcast, or during
well,
the broadcast.
Well, he wept during it, yes. He used to cry rather easily. I mean, he was a very sad man underneath all that bluster. You know, he was a very nice man. And I can remember having lunch with him once in Brighton with my husband, and you only had to mention the war or the Air Force or mother, because he adored his mother, and he used to burst into tears. Mm. And this all happened in a public dining room. We wished the floor would open and swallow us up. But he was already not well.
Perhaps his ill health led to the fact that he was rather cantankerous on the air, wasn't he?
Terribly cantankerous. Well, and Ken used to direct What's My Line. So he had a marvellous ploy, because Gilbert always complained about the lights. So he always had the lights so hot, he used to say, put everything on. And Gilbert used to come in and start, and he'd say, Gilbert, we will put them out for you. And then he used to go to normal lighting, which he'd have had anyway, and Gilbert was happy.
The announcers, the people that did your job, there were only about, what, four of you, weren't there, in four main...
Well, originally there were only three, Mary, Mac and myself.
Yes.
And then we got a few more, yes.
Yes.
Peter Haig came, Alex McIntosh, yes. But we were sort of there for years, just the three of us.
But you were terribly famous in those years, weren't you?
I suppose so, yes.
Well, you were, without a doubt. And you, in actual fact, it always seemed to me you were more famous and more popular than the people who were actually in the programmes that you announced. Partly because you were on so much.
Well, we were on all the time, yes, it's that. I mean, now they don't have this, but we were up in between every programme. And, of course, there were so many breakdowns, we were always, you know, coming up and... Yeah. Trying to calm the populace and say, you know, have a cup of tea and we'll put you a lovely interlude on, all those lovely calming interludes.
Yes, we're showing some of them in the series.
Yes, I know. Yes.
But what sort of situations were you in when it broke down? Did you always have to sit there or were you off having a cup of tea?
I had to sit in the control room. Oh, it was awful, actually. I used to have to sit in a very hot, rather smelly control room. I used to throw the cologne all over the place, rather pointedly at times. But you had to be there because, I mean, if there was a breakdown, you had to rush in the studio and, you know, do something about it.
Yes. Did you have... I think you had an awful lot of fans in those days, mostly male fans.
Well, I had a few women as well, I think.
Yes. Mostly male fans.
Lots of elderly gentlemen, I think.
What, when you were 20?
Yes, I think so.
But you got reams of letters, didn't you? And things.
Yes. I had a mystery man who used to... send me postcards from all over the world. I never found out who he was, actually.
Yes. Next clip you've picked for us is of more recent times, and it's the Victoria Wood show.
Yes, well, I love Victoria Wood. I think she's so funny. And I don't like many female comics, but I think she's brilliant.
In this clip, she doesn't appear herself.
No, sadly, but I love Acorn Antiques. I hope Julie Waters reminds me of early editions of Crossroads, I'm afraid. When they're waiting for their cues and they don't quite know their lives.
Exactly. Didn't you have to stand in for the Queen at one stage in your career?
I didn't exactly stand in. Before her first Christmas broadcast, I made a sort of a training film for her. Five different ways to do a Christmas broadcast to the nation. Yes.
Five different ways?
Five different ways.
What sort of ways?
Don't ask me the five now, I can't remember. No. Well, either with autocue, without autocue, reading all the time, learning it, which is horrendous. Or
impossible,
I would say. Impossible. Yes. Or a mixture of autocue and looking at the script. And I did one of her Christmas speeches, which was deeply embarrassing, actually. I felt very embarrassed doing it. I did the one of the year before. And then it was sent to Balmoral, and I think she just looked at it, and she was fine.
And did Her Majesty take your advice as to how to go about it, whether to use
autocue? She used the best method, in my view. I mean, she chose the method of using autocue, but looking away occasionally, because if you can't, you know, if you're just glassy-eyed at it, I think that's terrible. No, but she did use the best way, I thought.
And were you there when the Queen actually did the broadcast, or were you...
Yes, I think I was on duty that day. I wasn't with her, no. She did it from Sandringham.
Oh,
I mean,
right.
In those days, she had to do it live, which must have ruined her Christmas lunch.
I'm sure it must.
All the time.
I'm sure it must.
Yes, but we actually did see even the rehearsal. She was marvellous. I mean, they were beamed through to the control room so that we could look at her.
Yes. You've picked a royal clip, as it were, for us now, Princess Anne.
Yes.
Her appearance on the Wogan Show.
Because I admire Princess Anne tremendously, not only for the work she does, but she's a brilliant after-dinner speaker, off the cuff.
Oh, yes, a great wit.
And very lovely sense of humour, as comes over, I think, in this interview. Mm-hmm.
Who offers you advice on how to cope with these appearances? What to do, what to say? Or do you generally learn from experience yourself? I know you write all your own speeches.
No, I think you learn the hard way, mostly.
Well, obviously, Her Majesty the Queen must have a few tips for you. And as you go on, do you, for instance, give any advice to, say, the Princess of Wales on how to deal with engagements?
It's not... I don't know whether you call it advice or not. You can only repeat, I think, your own experiences and the problems that you've had and the way you've countered them or got over them, or, you know, the things, I can still remember what it was like when I first started.
You said that like a dowager.
I'm practicing. It is important to be able to remember what it was like when you first started and, you know, how you struggled to think of things to say and what sort of line of you were going to take and sort of questions you were likely to ask and how people react. But that, it really does only come with experience and you can only help, if it helps, by telling you how, you know, you found it. And of course, each individual reacts completely differently, so, you know, she may find it completely useless information. It's not something she thought of.
You've sometimes found, I think, certainly in the past, though not lately, that the press in particular have occasionally, if not misinterpreted, certainly misreported what you've said. How has that struck you? It's obviously you haven't liked it.
No, it can be very irritating.
Tell me, do you get recognised much nowadays?
No, not that much, no. Just occasionally. Mm. People don't know who I am. They just say, your face is sort of familiar. And I would say, well, you must know me because I live in the area or something. Yeah. I never let on.
But you left full-time television terribly early, didn't you?
I was quite young, really, yes, to look after my daughter, yes. And then I went into the rag trade. I had a shop for 20 years.
Oh, did you?
20 years in the rag. I wanted a clip of the rag trade, but somebody had that.
Oh, I see. We deprived you of that,
didn't
we?
Deprived me of that,
right.
Yes.
But did you ever think that you'd left television a little too early, that you should have perhaps gone on and done? What about other programmes? I mean, you did
Wesley announcing. Well, I did freelance, fortunately. I mean, I was able to... But I did things like Come Dancing, which is a joke, really, wasn't it? And children's programmes. And then I did advertising magazines. And if you did those in those days, the BBC would never... I mean, you really had gone over to the other side. Mm. I mean, you know, really, it was...
They wouldn't forgive you for that
No.
What effect... You were working full-time at the BBC when ITV opened up.
Yes.
Which was, what, 1955 or something
like that? Yes, 1955, yes.
And what effect did that have on the people working at the BBC at the time? Was
terrific
it all shock,
effect.
Horror? And...
Yes, because we had to suddenly tighten up. You see, we never ran to time. Everything was all very hazy-daisy. But then suddenly we had to work with a clock beside us and, you know, everything had to be spot on because ITV were running to time. So it gave us a jolt. It's probably very good for the BBC that they had that jolt.
Oh, I'm sure of it. Mm. Did anybody dangle the carrot in front of you at that time to go to the other side?
Yes, they did. Yes.
With bundles of money or...?
Well, not enough, shall we say. Well, I did go to ITV, because, as I say, I did advertising magazines. Mm. No, not that much.
Your next clip is one of my favourites, actually, from, what, 60s, I think, isn't it? The Forsyth
Saga. Oh, yes. Oh.
Broke all our hearts.
Wonderful, wonderful series, and this wonderful scene between Soames and Irene.
Yes.
Will you let me go?
How can I? We're married. Well, then don't talk such nonsense. Never, do you hear me? Never again. I won't put up with it.
Then you won't let me go?
What on earth would you do with yourself if I did? You've got no money.
I could manage somehow.
Once and for all, I will not have you say such things. It's wrong. And impossible. So never speak of it again.
Don't you understand? Do you still refuse to believe it? I loathe you, Soames. I loathe the very sight of you.
Don't like that blouse. It's a shapeless thing.
Don't touch me.
Where have you been? Tell me at once, where have you been?
In heaven. Out of this house. Soames, don't. Look, kill me if you like, but don't. I'd rather you killed me.
No, there's no need to kill you. No. Anybody can help you, can't they?
That absolutely captured the nation's interest, didn't it? That,
it was wonderful. Mm. Eric Porter and Nairi Dawn Porter. And I believe that so everybody was watching it, and that even the power used to go down. The electricity board had to put a bit more power going because there were no videos in those days. I mean, it was the most gripping, beautifully acted serial and went all over the world.
Yes.
When I remember seeing it in Paris, dubbed in beautiful French. And the tragedy is it could have been made in colour, but they thought it was too expensive to do it at that time.
Was didn't the colour TV around then?
There
when
was,
that was made?
Yes. They could have made it in colour, but they felt, you know, it would have been very costly. And I suppose they had no idea how wonderful it was going to be.
Now, you started as a dancer, and you've,
yes, I did.
You've selected some dance.
Well, yes.
For
this
us
is
now.
Going back to my beginnings. My great heroine, Margot Fonteyn, and when I was a ballet student myself, I used to queue up and pay 1 and 6 to go in the New Theatre Gallery to watch her dance. And I loved her series, The Magic of Dance. I hope we're going to hear a little bit of her talking and to see her with Nureyev in Marguerite and Armand, which I think was the ballet which suited the two of them the best.
Okay.
Perhaps I wouldn't have chosen ballet as a profession if I'd known that staying at the top once you get there is rather like running up a down-going escalator. If you stop running, down you go. But then that's the fun of it. It's the challenge that we love, and also the dancing. Those hours spent in the classes and rehearsals that outsiders usually think are so onerous are sometimes the best part, when we can put our whole heart into it without having to worry about the audience. Those can be very magical moments. But so far as I'm concerned, if it's the pas de châle or the cha-cha-cha, the rumba, the samba, the Morris dance, or the grand pas de deux, it's all the magic of dance.
your favourites.
Beautiful, and Nureyev was at his peak then, wasn't he?
Mm. Tell me something, did you have any really ghastly moments in front of the camera when you were announcing? Apart from the jokes and japes they
the
played
on you. The jokes are the worst, yes. I didn't ever dry. I was very boring because of this memory of mine. Things used to happen, like sort of scenery falling down, but then I just used to carry on regardless. One of my worst moments was never seen, actually, because I did this programme in France with Richard, and the ending, the last programme we did, was really appalling. With a producer, every time I was talking for something in long shot, he went to a close-up and, you know, vice versa. And the ending was a helicopter was going to come down and I was to run and greet the pilot. Yeah. But they hadn't told me about the kind of downdraft. And as I ran, my skirts went right over my head. And for once in my life, I really was mad and I threw the microphone down and I ran away.
Yes.
But somebody in their infinite mercy at the BBC, long before then, had pulled the plug and said, this programme must not be seen. So it didn't actually go out.
May Gray.
Oh, yes.
Was one of your
tremendous favourites. Tremendous favourite, yes. Mm. I loved, anyway, the stories. I loved France. I loved Rupert Davis. I believe it may come back, too.
Yes, I hope so. Did they let you on things like What's My Line? And
yes, I was guest celebrity on that. I used to do a lot of OBs. I used to do the fashions at Ascot, which was quite hilarious, because in those days I was allowed to wander about the crowd with a hidden mic. And as the only belt they had for a mic, which you wear now and I do, was Richard Dimbleby's. Which went round
his
me about...
His was the only portable one, was it?
Yes, it was an enormous leather thing, so I had to wear very full skirts. And I used to wander about the crowd and sort of describe people's clothes, not always in complimentary terms. And the Duke of Norfolk complained, probably quite rightly, and I was then put away somewhere where I couldn't mingle.
Did you find it easy to go anywhere in those days? I mean,
no.
Were you...
It was difficult, but it must be even worse today.
Well, I'm not so sure it is, really, because I think people are so much more used to television these days. I mean, there were so few of you, really, that were major stars in those times that...
Do you think that made it worse? It was extremely difficult. If you went out to dinner, people would be watching or every mouthful. You know, it was a bit hard.
Mm. Well, you've got a little humour for us now. Monty Python.
Yes, love it.
The parrot. The dead parrot.
That's just funny today.
It'll never fade away, that
one. It's a classic.
It is a classic indeed.
It's lovely.
Your days in television, have they given you pleasure in retrospect? Do you look back on them fondly?
Oh, they were halcyon days, yes. Especially the early days. Well, we all had such fun. We didn't take it seriously, I don't think. But it was just like a lovely family, and we were all so happy together.
And it's lovely meeting you.
Thank you.
It's Sylvia
so
Peters,
nice
ladies
to meet
and gentlemen.
You.
Goodbye for now.